So why should we measure cervical length in pregnancy? There are currently over 1,500 published papers in the literature that attest its usefulness in the prediction and prevention of preterm birth, in the evaluation of symptomatic preterm labor, and in the optimal timing of elective and mean cesarean sections. I'll start by outlining the proper technique of measuring cervical length. And first of all, I want to make sure you all understand when we talk about cervical sonography, we do not talk about transabdominal ultrasound, but about transvaginal or endovaginal ultrasound. Because in transabdominal ultrasound, successful visualization requires a full bladder, which will falsely increase cervical length, and you can miss a cervix that is otherwise shortened or open. Transvaginal ultrasound is now the gold standard for visualization of the cervix. Technique itself is very important, and I want to review it in detail. Once again, you need to make sure that the patient has emptied her bladder before the ultrasound. You use a special condom or even a regular latex glove to cover the gel-tipped ultrasound probe. You insert it into the vagina and direct it in the anterior fornix. You try to obtain a sagittal view of the cervix using the endocervical mucosa as a guide to the true position of the internal os, thereby avoiding confusion with the lower segment of the uterus. You should also take care to avoid exerting undue pressure on the cervix, since that may artificially increase its length. As you can see in this picture, here is the internal os, and here is the external os. You want to make sure you don't put too much pressure on the cervix. You enlarge the image as much as you can, and you obtain at least 3 different measurements, and use the shortest, best measurement that gets a view of the whole cervix. The total examination of the cervix should last at least a few minutes, because over such time, you may detect spontaneous changes with contractions. You want to make sure that you standardize your technique and you do it the same way all the time, that the anterior lip of the cervix is similar in thickness to the posterior lip, that you see the hole in the cervical canal, and that again there is no increased echogenicity of the anterior lip. Transvaginal ultrasound of the cervix has been shown to be really the most predictive test for preterm birth, because the cervix, when it's going to open, it begins to open at the internal os, a finding that you cannot detect on manual examination. Again, you can take multiple measurements of transvaginal ultrasound, as you can see in this slide. But cervical length, or the closed part of the cervix, even if there is a little bit of an opening up at the internal os, is what you want to measure. So cervical length is the distance from the external os to the end of the closed part of the endocervical mucosa. As you can see here, the measurement in a normal long cervix is 2.5 to 5 centimeters. And when you're measuring a short cervix, again, you don't want to measure the whole length of the cervix, but you want to measure the length of the cervix that is staying closed, at least to more functional length. You can also mention in your report the opening here called funneling, the degree of which is the ratio B over A plus B in terms of measurements in this slide, but that really does not add much to your prediction. Dilatation of the internal os, observed sonographically as funneling, is no more than a simple reflection of the process of producing cervical shortening that will eventually result in preterm delivery. Almost all women with short cervix have funneling of internal os. Women with a long cervix and some funneling are not at increased risk of preterm delivery. Sometimes you see a cervix that is curved, and you can still measure in a straight line the distance between the external os and internal os. But usually when the distance between the mid-cervical canal and the line joining the two ostia is more than 5 millimeters, it's better to take these two measurements and add them up, or you can even trace the actual length along the endocervical canal. Again, when you have a curved cervix, this usually means that it is a long cervix, whereas a short cervix is almost always straight. Now, there are several potential pitfalls of transvaginal ultrasound. both anatomic and technical, and you want to make sure to avoid them. As you can see in these old sonograms, we used to not be too attentive to emptying the bladder, but it is very important to empty the bladder. These bladders are too full and we mask some funneling that is probably happening in this case in front of the red arrow. So again, we want to make sure that the bladder is completely empty, and if there is any fluid in the bladder, it's a little bit of a slit there, and the cervix appears to be in its natural state. You don't want to put too much pressure on the probe, and you can see that by the fact that here the echogenicity of the anterior lip is excessive. This anterior lip is too wide, so to speak, and it is also much thinner than the non-compressed posterior lip of the cervix. Now, assuming correct technique and the vaginal ultrasonic measurement of cervical length is highly reproducible to within 4 millimeters or less. But how much time does it take to learn to apply the proper technique? According to Vincenzo Barghella from Philadelphia, you need at least 50 practice sessions to acquire it reliably, whereas for EFIL from Paris, roughly 23 supervised ultrasound scans are necessary for a sonographer with no experience in endovaginal ultrasound. More recently, George Stade and colleagues sought to assess adherence to the protocol by evaluating almost 5,000 images submitted by 327 sonographers for certification purposes. 784 deficient images submitted by those who failed the certification, 60% were rejected because of improper measurement due to incorrect caliper placement or failure to identify the shortest best image. And 40% were rejected because of failure to obtain a satisfactory image due to excessive compression, required landmarks not visible, incorrect image size, too brief an examination, or a foreign bladder. The authors concluded that there should be increased attention to standardized education and credentialing for persons who perform ultrasound examinations of the cervix in pregnancy. Now, what is the clinical value of measuring cervical length in pregnancy? It is clinically useful in predicting the likelihood of delivery within the following 7 days and will be presenting with painful contractions and flattened preterm labor, and in the remote prediction of preterm delivery in asymptomatic mid-trimester pregnant women long before the actual event. In patients presenting with painful uterine contractions in the preterm period, cervical length measurement has become essential for their evaluation, because the risk of spontaneous preterm delivery in such women within 7 days is inversely related to cervical length and increases exponentially when the cervical length is less than 15 millimeters in singletons and less than 25 millimeters in twins. So in flattened preterm labor, cervical length measurement allows you to distinguish between women in false preterm labor and women in true preterm labor who need to be hospitalized and given tocolysis and steroids to ensure the fetal lives. Just a word about fetal fibronectin. Its presence in cervical vaginal secretions is useful in distinguishing between true and false preterm labor, but it really does not improve the prediction of delivery within 7 days provided by the sonographic measurement of cervical length alone. So women with a singleton fetus and flattened preterm labor, cervical length more than 15 millimeters, do not need tocolysis because they are in forced labor. And for twin pregnancies, the cutoff is 25 millimeters. But what about pregnant women who have no symptoms at all? Can we use cervical length measurement for the remote prediction of preterm birth? These are classic data from blinded studies of transvaginal ultrasound in singleton pregnancies without any interventions. And you can see the natural history of their outcomes. They were screened with cervical ultrasound in the second trimester between 16 and 24 weeks, and a cervical length of less than 25 millimeters was tested as a predictor of preterm birth at less than 25 weeks. While a cervical length above 25 millimeters was reassuring as for the outcome, the sensitivity of cervical length below 25 millimeters was quite low in low-risk women and much better in high-risk women with a prior pre-trans birth. The positive predictive value was also much higher in high-risk than in low-risk women. So really, as a test, cervical length measurement will not do too well in low-risk women with no prior pre-trans birth. It will do best in singleton pregnancies with a previous pre-trans birth, a previous cervical excisional procedure, or with a uterine malformation. In twins, cervical length measurement will not do that well either. The positive predictive value is actually high because we have a high incidence of pre-trans birth, but the sensitivity is quite low, and that's why looking at the cervix in twin pregnancies will not really help too much in predicting pre-trans birth. Now, at what stage of pregnancy and how often should you screen an asymptomatic pregnant woman? If you want to screen for preterm birth risk in a low-risk patient, then I would recommend you do it just once around 18 to 22 weeks. Obviously, if you do it more often, the prediction is stronger, but that more frequent screening should really be reserved for patients at high risk of preterm birth, such as those with previous preterm birth, at whom we often do screening every 2 weeks, between 16 and 24 weeks of gestation. Now, how would you manage the asymptomatic gravida with a short cervix and mid-pregnancy? Studies investigating the value of preventive measures have essentially focused on women with a previous preterm delivery who have a short cervix in the pregnancy of their current study. Would prophylactic cerclage be helpful, or vaginal progesterone, or would you just prescribe bed rest? Again, Roxad and colleagues published a study last year of 646 asymptomatic malliparous women with a short cervix in the mid-trimester, and it may come as a surprise to some of you that they found that women who were prescribed activity restriction were significantly more likely to deliver preterm. Activity restriction has been associated with increased stress and anxiety and an increased risk for adverse pregnancy outcomes. And there is actually no proven benefit from either bed rest or prophylactic tocolytics in the prevention of preterm birth in asymptomatic women with a short cervix. And if you have not noticed, this study was on low-risk pregnancies, but even in high-risk singleton pregnancies with previous preterm birth, this Cochrane database review found no evidence that bed rest prevents recurrent preterm birth. As for cerclage, the mid-trimester cervical length is less than 25 millimeters in asymptomatic pregnant women with a single fetus and a previous preterm birth. Cervical cerclage has been shown to reduce the preterm delivery rate before 35 weeks by a significant 30%. Cervical length should be measured every 2 weeks, from 14 to 24 weeks, and cerclage may be advised if that length drops below 25 millimeters before 24 weeks. Obviously, for the cerclage to work, it has to be properly placed. Here is an ultrasound of the cerclage that is not going to prevent anything because it has slipped out of the posterior lip and came to rest in the anterior lip of the cervix due to improper anchoring. Just a quick word about the prophylactic use of progesterone. For singleton pregnancies at high risk for preterm birth with a short cervix, daily treatment with 200 milligrams of vaginal progesterone offers about the same benefit as cerclage. The same cannot be said, however, about the injectable form. A randomized control trial published online just 2 weeks ago in the American Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology concluded that weekly injections of 500 milligrams of 17-hydroxyprogesterone caprolate were useless for the prevention of preterm birth in high-risk singleton pregnancies with a short cervix. Going back to cerclage, it is not beneficial if the cervix is discovered to be short beyond 24 weeks in asymptomatic high-risk singleton pregnancies. But Fadi Mirza and colleagues found that such patients 23 to 28 weeks, rarely deliver within the next 2 weeks, and best followed closely to allow optimal timing of steroid therapy close to the time of delivery. Now, this mid-trimester screening with cervical length usually done universal to all pregnant women, we are still not sure. A recent large study published only 2 months ago in the Green Journal evaluated universal screening of low-risk singleton pregnancies with sonographic cervical length and found that the incidence of spontaneous preterm birth was similar in those who were screened and in those who were not screened. Actually, neither the Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine nor the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists currently mandate universal cervical length screening. But both do state that this screening strategy may be considered in singleton gestations without prior spontaneous preterm birth, especially that prophylactic vaginal progesterone treatment of such women with a very short cervix seems to be beneficial. This is not the case for self-clutch. I'll have more on this in a minute. But let's first look at twin pregnancies. The rate of spontaneous preterm birth before 34 weeks in twin pregnancies is about 13%, much higher than in singletons. And several randomized studies have shown that cervical self-clutch, those with a short cervix, doubles the risk of early preterm birth. So self-clutch is detrimental and currently contraindicated in twin pregnancies. We should not do any self-clutches in twins. On the other hand, progesterone for short cervix in twin pregnancies is not harmful like self-clutch, but it does not seem to help either. Now this is the current official American College algorithm for management of the short cervix in pregnancy. Singleton pregnancies with no previous preterm birth who are found on routine screening to have a short cervix should be offered vaginal progesterone supplementation, whereas the clutch should be considered in singleton pregnancies with a previous preterm birth who already are on progesterone and who develop a short cervix. Unfortunately for twins or triplets with a short cervix, no intervention or treatment have been shown to improve outcome. Finally, going back to singleton pregnancies, cervical length measurement at 37 weeks can be of practical help in scheduling elective repeat cesareans at term. There is actually a built-in contradiction in choosing the optimum time for elective cesarean. Do it in the early term and you run the non-negligible risk of neonatal RDS and transfer to the NICU with its attendant parental anxiety and potential blame of why so early. Delay until 39 to 40 weeks to gain assurance of no neonatal RDS, and you will have a substantial proportion of these women go into spontaneous labor, turning an elective procedure into an emergency one, especially that many such women have an uncanny way of starting painful contractions in the middle of the night. In such cases, cervical length measurement with transvaginal ultrasound at 37 weeks can help strike a balance between the safety needs of the mother and those of the newborn, not to mention the own. This graph shows the effect of cervical length at 37 weeks on the gestational age at which spontaneous labor occurs. Almost all women with a cervical length of more than 30 millimeters at 37 weeks will not go into spontaneous labor before 39 and a half weeks, while women with a cervical self-clutch less than 20 millimeters at 37 weeks, 80% will go into spontaneous labor before 39 weeks, and 35% even before 38 weeks. So if the cervical length at 37 weeks is longer than 30 millimeters, you can easily wait until 39 or even 40 weeks to do your cesarean electively. If it is 21 to 30 millimeters at 37 weeks, and do the cesarean at 38 weeks. And if it is less than 20 millimeters at 37 weeks, it would seem best if you do the cesarean in the following few days before the patient goes into active labor. And finally, to wrap up this talk, I have gone over the proper technique of cervical length measurement and detailed its usefulness in the evaluation of preterm labor and the remote prediction and prevention of preterm birth and in optimizing the timing active and mean cesarean deliveries. I thank you for your attention.